We now have Professor Judy Baumel Schwartz, my co-host, whose name goes ahead of her. She's a professor of many places. So, Judy, I welcome you to give your contribution.
Okay, thank you very much. We are only 30 minutes late, and it says on the program that I have 15 minutes to speak, and guess what? I will not do that to you. And therefore, we're going to just cut all my visual presentation. I'll show you one picture at the end, and let's start. We are talking about post-memory. What is post-memory? We've been talking about it now for 2 hours, but let's give a really good definition. It's not your memory, but now it is. And that's like how a study becomes a source. That's what we're dealing with here. It was somebody else's memory, today it's ours. The topic that we're talking about, writing the unwritable. Most of our participants spoke about written memory, performative memory, like games and toys, educational memory, memory as a result of studies. I'm gonna talk about a very different memory. I'm going to talk about something that combines all of the above that I call final post-memory. Now, what could be more final than tombstones? And that's what I'm going to talk about. I'm doing it on the most personal level with a personal story, a personal memory, and then I'm going to branch out and see how it relates to all of us. Background. This is about me, or it's actually about my family. My father was a Holocaust survivor, what we call 1G, first generation. He lost a wife, parents, and a sister in the Holocaust. My mother was American born. She was 3G, third generation. She lost grandparents, aunts, cousins in the Holocaust. My grandmother used to say to me, gee, you and I are both second generation, which is interesting, but also true. Now a little bit of what we call death chronology. My father passed away in 1993. Throughout his lifetime, he never talked about what he wanted on his tombstone. And actually, tombstone was not really a topic in our family because none of his family who had, I can't say perished, murdered, none of his family who were murdered during the Holocaust had tombstones. So that was something really new. He never talked about what he wanted mentioned, if there would be anything. He left it all up to us. So there I am standing in front of an empty grave and I'm saying, so what am I going to put on his tombstone? Believe it or not, here I am, Holocaust scholar. It never occurred to me to even think of putting on his tombstone the fact that he was a survivor. He was a man who lived in the present. He was a man who always looked towards the future. Right after the war, he created a post-war kibbutz that he brought to Israel. I certainly knew he was a Holocaust survivor. When I thought how to define him, that wasn't what I thought about. However, I did know that I had on his side grandparents and an aunt and what I call my stepmother, in other words, my half-brother and sister's mother, who were killed during the Holocaust. We wanted to memorialize them, we meaning my half brother and sister and I. So what we ended up doing was having a standing stone for my father. And in Israel, you have a lying down stone very often. So on the lying down stone, we had something very short, that a small text that said in memory of his parents with their name, his sister with her name and his first wife with her name, who were murdered during the Holocaust. End of story. Now, let's take it to the other side. My mother's chronology. A very different story. She always talked about what she wanted on her tombstone. She kept telling me that she had make sure that I would put her parents, meaning her grandparents, my great grandparents, and her two aunts, one who was killed in Babi Yar in Russia, the other one who died in Transnistria, also was murdered. They should be memorialized on her tombstone. Interesting, her grandparents did have tombstones. They were buried, but nobody knows where their graves are today. And therefore, when they went back to look for them in Transnistria, as if they don't exist. My mother died in 2014. In fact, today is 7 years, the English date of her death, if we're already talking about coincidences. And I made a short inscription on her lying down stone, again, in memory of her grandparents, in memory, et cetera, et cetera. Now, what is post-memory? Not our memories, somebody else's memories that we turn into memories that we put on a stone, but that's only the middle of the story. Now begins the transformation. At some point in the past 7 years, I sat down to write a book. I wrote a book about my mother. And doing so, I had the privilege of thousands of pages of correspondence between my mother and me. I saved every note, every page, every letter that she sent to me from the day we moved to Israel 47 years ago. I used to joke and say, one day when you're gone, this is what I'm going to have. When I was going through the papers, all of a sudden I found a letter a letter that she had written me 30 years ago, in which she wrote, "On my tombstone, remember to put my grandparents, my aunts, so far so good, and now comes the bad part, and the years they died, the places they were killed, oops, bad." Talk about the shoemaker's children going barefoot. I had forgotten that part. So there is a Hebrew concept called tikkun, fixing something. When did I fix it? A year and a half ago, I celebrated my 60th birthday. Now, you know the quandary. What are we going to get mommy for her birthday? And my husband, what am I going to get Judy for my birthday? So I made life easier for everyone. I said, guess what I want for my birthday? I want a tombstone. What? I said, no, not mine. Don't worry. I want to redo my parents' tombstones. I felt that my mother had given me a list of what she wanted. I hadn't carried it out. And if we already have share screen, as I talk, let's see if it works. I had prepared it. This, am I sharing? Not yet. Hold on. Let me see if I can do this. So lo and behold, here we go. Can you see? Wait, let's see. Is it coming up? Do we see anything? Yes, you should see it now. Okay, this was my father's original lying down, short memorial. And here you can see this long Megillah that we wrote, in which I made sure that every person, who their parents were, where they were buried, where they weren't buried, what they went through in the war. My mother's original stone in the memory of her grandfather, her grandmother, her aunt. I didn't even know her aunt who was killed in Babi Yar. I didn't even know her married name. I used my grandfather's name because I didn't know anything else. But when I wrote the book, I found documentation. And as you can see, we have the entire thing. What I did add at the bottom is the Hebrew expression, Hashem Yikom Damam. May the Lord avenge their memories, their blood. Now, let's stop screen sharing. Hold on a second. Stop share. And let's get to the end of the story. Why did I do all of this? I've got to tell you, a tombstone is not cheap. And to do two tombstones is even more expensive. Why did I want that for my 60th birthday? Not only because I felt guilt that my mother had asked for something and I didn't do it right. It's like the last thing I could do for her. But it's more than that. I'm a historian. I read tombstones as texts. And as I said, the shoemaker's children, in this case, the shoemaker's parents, go barefoot. This is one's last big post-memorial text. What is going to be on a tombstone? And therefore, I was going to do it right. So what are our conclusions? How are we doing in terms of time? 7 minutes, not bad. Our conclusions, Holocaust tombstone post-memory is the final post-memory. It's also the finite post-memory, if you think about it, because this, I'm not the only person who does this, who memorializes people on from the Holocaust on their parents' tombstone or their tombstone in most cases, but it's going to end. Because when I think about it, so when my time really does come, we've memorialized everybody. I'm second generation. There's no more. My third generation kids aren't going to have to memorialize people from the Holocaust because they've been memorialized. So this is it. This is the memorial. And many survivors, and I can tell you how many in a second, many survivors try to memorialize their murdered family this way. I know that this is not only in Israel, because I'm in the middle of writing a big article for Phyllis, as you remember, on this topic. And to do so, I actually went to the cemetery under lockdown, don't tell anybody, one rainy day, but who's going to tell on me? There's nobody in the cemetery. And I went through something like 1,500 tombstones just in one section. And I went from row to row and row to row, and I took pictures and I read every single memorial. There were hundreds of them, hundreds and hundreds of people memorialized their family. So guess what, folks? You know what the one thing that we can all do is that when we go to a cemetery, for whatever reason, look around and read those memorials. That's the one thing that we can do to remember those people. So finally, I thank everybody here for participating, because this conference in itself is a post-memorial act. And by participating, we have all become part of the process. Thank you all.